Hello, welcome everyone to another episode of the Virtual Ninja Show. My name is Heike and I have two returning guests with me today, and I will start with Malvika. Please introduce yourself.
Well, hi Heike, and thank you for having me back on the show. I'm looking forward to walking through some of our team's protection features.
Yes, you're already getting right into the topic, but let's also have Daniel introduce himself.
Hi Heike, glad to be back. Thanks for inviting us and having us. Excited to share more about this topic.
Yes. So we are going to talk about Teams protection. And I'm actually really excited about it because I use Teams all the time. And so do many of our customers. And we want them to be protected with all the things that can occur, right? So external people pinging someone, you get a link, you get a document, you get all these things that are normal to us, but they can also be dangerous. So let's set a little bit the stage and the context to why Teams protection is actually important. And I think I'm pointing to you, Malvika.
Yeah, so just like you mentioned, Teams protection, kind of Teams in general, has become kind of the backbone of a lot of modern collaboration. And there's over 320 million users and it's constantly growing. So because of this like popularity, it's also become kind of a high value attack surface for a lot of our attackers. And so securing Teams has really become essential. We found it to be a valuable tool for targeting customers through phishing, malware, and malicious activities. And we've seen 126% increase in phishing attacks. We're now tracking over 300 threat actors that are actively exploiting Teams through multimodal attacks. So really a large growing threat vector. And so it's become essential for us to continue to invest there and protect the surfaces that we're using the most.
So when we think about today, I mean, we have good protection and good coverage, right? So I think, can we quickly summarize a little bit about what customers are protected of? And maybe Daniel, I'm looking to you. I don't know. We can share. Everybody says something.
Yes. Yes, absolutely. So this is not a new area. We are investing in Teams protection since for a while. Obviously, we delivered over the years time of click protection in Teams. So against malicious URLs, if somebody interacts with that, we have that protection. Safe links is extended to Teams. Long time ago, we do have the file protection integration as well. So we're protecting against malicious files. What we are worked on in the last, let's say, few months is to elevate this to message levels in new use cases and scenarios as threat actors are moving around Teams and trying to exploit different areas of Teams surfaces to engage with users. We invested in to make sure there is enough protection, detection, investigation, and response coverage as well.
Mm-hmm. So I think let's actually jump right into the demo and walk us through and help us a little bit understand what's going on and what's happening and what we are seeing also.
Yeah. So we are actually happy to introduce a new feature that is now in public preview. And so that's kind of what we're going to be walking through today. So as you can see here, we have somebody mimicking or acting like Microsoft support trying to contact my user. Because this is the first time that they're trying to contact me, I see this page where I can accept the conversation, preview it, or just block the conversation entirely. So in this case, I see some messages here. So I'm going to go ahead and accept the conversation. And then I see that they're sharing some details about my laptop and my iPhone. And I also see a warning message on the top there. So the warning is something that we newly released. So as messages kind of go and come through and get delivered into the team system, we are proactively detecting any known malicious URLs, and we're going to be delivering the message with that URL warning. So in this case, I now know that this could contain some malicious content. It's also an external user. And so as a result, it might not be something I want to interact with.
So Malvika, before you continue, what happens in the background here? Is this already the file went through safe link, safe attachment, safe files, whatever it's called, and you already have a verdict here? Or why is this message showing up? Just because it's an external link?
Yeah, so what happens is actually going through our system, through some of our known malicious, like known malicious links, we detect it and we already know that it is malicious as it's getting delivered. And so because of that, it gets delivered with the link. So it's using a lot of the signals across MDO to be able to identify that and flag it as a warning and malicious content.
Yeah, how I explain Heike to a lot of our customers asking similar questions is, how is this different from safe links protection? Safe links is time of click. You would need to click to get to a blockstream. What the idea was here, if we already know the URL is malicious, can we up-level that malicious signal to the message level? So warn the user so the user doesn't interact with the message. Can be other URLs in the message and can be other problems in it. So it's an awareness of that malicious URL on the message level. So it's easier to the user to slow down and take care because there can be malicious content here.
Yeah, absolutely makes sense, right? Why do we first need to have the user click something malicious? So this is awesome. Thank you for explaining.
Yeah, and on top of that, we're also adding like post-delivery protection. So if something does come in and then it becomes weaponized after delivery, we'll also go back and add that warning tip. So users and end users are kind of protected end-to-end here.
Yeah, I would like to also call out, because this is something we were very intentional when we worked on this feature, to make sure this is also works in every Teams client. So you will have very similar experiences if you use not just a desktop Teams client or web client, you will have the same on mobile clients like iOS and Android. The features we are working on, we're trying to make sure there is client coverage. So it doesn't matter which device you are using for Teams, like protection capabilities are there.
Mm. Yeah, consistency across the different platforms. That's awesome. Cool. Thank you.
Okay, so I will take over from here. We're shifting a little bit of gears, and we also not just focusing on in the last few months on protection works. We also want to make sure we also give tools to the end users. They can give signals back to the security operation teams. One of the key for we thinking about your security program is your user should be one of your line of defense. And if they see something suspicious and they think it's worth to report to back to security operations, they can do that in Teams now as well. So the news is here is you can report Teams messages, malicious or suspicious Teams messages, right from the Teams client. And this is not possible for external messages as well. The idea was here is the same report fish button you have in Outlook. We just work with the Teams team to make it available in Teams clients as well. So if you think you get a message from a suspicious sender and you think this message is bad and it didn't get warned, didn't get blocked, then you can just go to the context menu of the message and click on report this message as a security risk. Okay, so this is the intent here. You would like to tell the security team this message is bad.
I was just wondering, why would we like to encourage users like me and you and others to actually report that message? Sometimes I feel like okay, yeah, it's just another reporting something. But why is it important?
Yeah. So this actually feeds into a lot of our signals and really helps improve our detection. So these messages that get reported by end users, they end up coming to us at Microsoft. And it's something that we investigate and we look into to help improve our detections going forward. So I'll just continue to improve what we protect and what we block and what we warn on.
So, but the message, the reporting also goes to the internal security team of that tenant, right?
Yes. So this can be configured to go to the internal security team as well. And then their security admins can also view all of the messages that have been reported by their end users.
And they show up by them in another email or in a Teams client, or how do they get notified about that reported message?
That's a great question, Heike. Let me walk you through what the day of life of security operation team member when it's coming to this workflow. The idea was here we integrate directly where the SecOps team's analysts are. So when you push the button as a user, you think something is malicious or suspicious. The workflow is very, very similar like what's happening in email as well. It's generating a signal into your security team. in form of an incident in the Defender XDR portal. It's in the same queue. The analyst can triage it, investigate it, and take response actions as well if it's needed. They can search for in the incident queue. All controls are available. The reported messages will correlate to other incidents as well. So you can filter the experience to find out user-reported Teams messages. That's your focus of your day. But they will be part of existing incidents cross workloads. And then you will just see it as a new signal, which you had no before. Not just the system thinks something is bad going on here. One of my users is thinking something is bad going on here. So this can kind of complete the visibility of the investigator. And the experience is built in a way like, yes, part of the incident, but you can follow investigation. If you would like to learn more about the Teams message, what is this, then there is experiences where you can go. Please find that reported Teams message for you in Defender XDR. And then you can start looking at deeper of the reported Teams message. For example, who sent it? Was it a chat? Was it a channel? What's the automatic triage? Malvika explained. Thinks about this message if it's sent to Microsoft. What was the result of the Microsoft investigation? What is the context of the message? We give you like a little snippet of the reported message. Was there any URL? Was there any threat found by the system on that URL? User thinks bad. Did the system learn based on that? There's all information available on these experiences. So analysts can go and do an investigation.
So what would an analyst now do with it? Like, you know, the user reports like, hey, there's like, you know, a weird message, which is good. And then the message is gone from the user and they're like, yeah, fine, don't see it anymore. But besides saying, let's submit it to Microsoft, or maybe it is part of a bigger incident, what do they do? Just asking for like, how do you operationalize all these messages that might come in a bigger organization?
That's a really great question. So there's a lot of actions that we are working on and we're also already have in place. So you can go and add something to a Tableau block list. So going directly into Tableau, we're also working on Tableau block a domain, which will be coming out soon as well. So this will kind of prevent end users from being able to click on these malicious URLs with safe links when they do go ahead and use it in their Teams client. So if customers do want to see more into some of the messages that have been submitted and reported, they can go into advanced hunting. We introduced three new advanced hunting tables specifically to be able to hunt on Teams messages, the message events, the post delivery events, and the message URL info. This kind of gives customers information on all of the Teams messages that contain URLs that are coming into their system, along with any post delivery actions that we have taken, and then URL information as well. So this is a very powerful tool to be able to do very deep investigations here. So as you can see here, we're looking for any Teams messages that are from external users that might contain a suspicious display name. So in the case where we were looking at the warning tip, we want to look for something with Microsoft security that has come from an external source. So we kind of run a query and we can see some examples here of messages that have been sent and received to users in the organization. So these kind of indicate that there could be some risk associated with them, given that it is looking like a Microsoft support sender, but is coming from an external organization.
And Danielle, we did an episode on GitHub, all the queries. Are they all in?
Not yet, but this is a great question. Not yet. Okay, I plug in here, like we do have an area in advanced hunting where we contribute with community queries, so ready to go advanced hunting queries. In fact, 2 weeks ago, we just checked in another batch of 150 new queries for Defender for Office. But yes, we have plans. It's on my to-do list in the next for the next few weeks to high number of Teams protection-related queries will come to the same area. We're collecting them right now from our internal research team, from ourselves, from our customers we are working with. Anything we see useful and impactful, yes, we will share with the community as usual.
Perfect. Because usually customers or like our attendees, they ask for where can I find the queries. So stay tuned. They're coming into the GitHub and then also within the portal. Good. Where are we going next? So we looked into the user. Does the user get notified about something that's happening with the message when it was solved?
Not today. So there is, of course, you can notify users yourself as a SOC analyst as part of your workflow, but not today. There is no automation to send back something to the user. This is something we are thinking about in the context of Teams, what is useful. It's not like, you know, like email, like where you, if you decide as an analyst this was bad, you can send back an email with Defender to the user, but that was an email reported, an email come back. We're thinking about what's the right way to build this out for the future. Should be an email come back from the SOC analyst opinion, or should be Teams message come back from the SOC analyst opinion? What's the right way to communicate in this scenario? But this is something we are considering for the future.
Mm. Some users, they appreciate it to hear something back like, hey, cool, thanks for submitting, like when you do this with an email. And for others, it's gone and forgotten. So yeah, not so easy.
Absolutely. All right, Heike, let's have a look on some more complex queries. This is an example we shared for Defender for Office as well. So I just tried to adopt it for a Teams use case. The idea here is you can get publicly access to third-party public IOC feeds, for example, for URLs in Teams. This is the threat vector. And you can integrate it within your hunting query. This is opening up interesting opportunities for you as a SOC team. For example, here I'm using this public list of URLs and then looking for, is anybody in my organization gets Teams message which contain this URL? This is useful for use cases to bringing threat intelligence to your system. And of course, because this is advanced hunting in Defender XDR, you can also think about some of these, you can build detections on it. You can save it as a custom detection rule with Defender XDR. You can save it to be automatically generate an incident in the SOC analyst queue when there is a hit, there is a match. They can run autonomously on a schedule, regular interval, and then they can help you to detect more based on other threat intelligence information, not just from us, Microsoft.
Mm-hmm. Wow, cool.
We might have a verdict as Microsoft on the same URLs, but usually this is useful in situation when we might not, but your internal or other feeds have you know, extended threat capabilities you can bring into your hunting.
So I think it's time to maybe talk a little bit about some of the things that are on our public roadmap, exciting features that are being developed and customers can look forward to. Malvika, do you think you can share something with us?
Yes, we have a lot of exciting new features that we're working on. And just to kind of give you a little bit of insight, we're going to be continuing to strengthen some of our SOC workflows just to allow for investigation and response to threats faster and more efficiently. We're also going to be bringing deeper context into investigations, with basically contextual like investigations on any threads and conversations. Right now, we're focused at the message level, so we're looking to bring that into threads. We're also going to be improving our detections with content-based phishing protections. And finally, we've been hearing this from a lot of our customers. We're going to be extending some of our protection investigation capabilities to meetings and calls just to help prevent abuse and detect any malicious activity across kind of all collaboration modes.
So this is awesome, Malvika. Thank you so much for sharing some. I mean, there's more and people can look at the page with all the other things that are in development. Daniel, last words from you. Call to action for the people. Go for it.
Yeah, exactly. We prepare some public guidance how to enable these capabilities. So we do have a deployment guide out there in public docs article. Look for in the MDO documentation. We will share the URL, the short URL for it. And on top of that, we're also always thinking about secret operation teams as well. They are top of mind for us. So we did create a public secret operation guides. How do you work with these workflows? What type of new capabilities in your workflows now light it up so you can investigate and respond easier to Teams related threats?
This is awesome. So thank you both for actually having been back on the show. And thanks everyone out there for watching, and talk soon. Bye.